Yeah, so I thought I should draw a picture, one more picture on the on what just happened on the three manifolds. It's not a proof picture, it's morally what's going on picture. So what we just did is take hyperbolic three manifold with finite volume. So again, I'm drawing it. With one cusp. And we decided to glue a solid torus on a section of the cusp. And what happened really is that, well, we choose a slope on which to glue it, and we take the slope very, very complicated. So on the unit solid torus here, the curve is like very, very long. And in order to glue it, we choose to go very, very high in the cusp so that the cusp is so thin. The length of the curve we have to glue is, I believe the correct constant is like 4 pi. So you have chosen a very, very long curve. But if you go deeper, far enough in the cusp, you find a moment where when you cut the length of this slope is just like a macroscopic quantity. And that's where you cut and you glue. That's what morally happened in all this this setting. You cut, you glue, and now the thing that you killed, it has translation length at least 4 pi, or at least whatever it takes, in the corresponding horosphere. That's what happened in this setting. So I like this picture because it's kind of convinced us of something else, which is actually true, which was, in some sense, is that when we go that far, that high, with this little tiny cusp that we cut, like 1 nanometer thick, and we glue something that one can barely see, how on earth can we change anything on the metric? Well, we can really, but if we do that properly, actually we change very little. We change very little on the whole metric, and that's part of all this this story, that the more complicated the denfeeling you're doing, the less you're modifying the metric on the hyperbolic manifold. And some kind of that statement is also true in relatively hyperbolic groups, but I won't go.
Does the finitely many slopes, bad slopes, depend on the m you started with?
It depends on the x you started with, if you want.
But in Christians, does it depend on the m, like for the this picture?
What is m?
The manifold you started with.
Oh, m. Yeah. Because it's always the same x. It's always a hyperbolic three space. Okay. So I'd like to talk about, so the title of the series of talk was Hyperbolicity and Generalizations. And so we have seen hyperbolic groups, relatively hyperbolic groups, and I'd like to finish with a weaker notion again. And So that would be about acylindrical hyperbolicity. So the definition is the following. A group G, let G be a group acting by isometries on a hyperbolic space. And we say that the action is acylindrical. If, I should say a delta hyperbolic space, because I will use delta. There exists R positive, such that for all x and y at distance r, the set of elements that move by a small quantity, so let's say 100 delta, it is enough to ensure the definition. Both of them is finite. Okay, a strange definition, but a definition. So, examples. Well, properly discontinuous actions. Proper actions. Because in proper actions, the set of G that move x at distance 100 delta is already finite. Another example maybe justifies the justifies the terminology is on trees. So no, let me say it like that. If you take an amalgamation A star B over C, over Z. Okay, A star B over Z. So an amalgamation, Z is a subgroup of A, a subgroup of B. You identify it, and that's it. So the topology, the topological space associated to this group, whose group is a fundamental group, would be like that. You have some space whose fundamental group is A, some space whose fundamental group is B. Somewhere you prefer an embedding of Z, and there you prefer the embedding on Z, and you identify it gluing a cylinder on both sides. Okay, to be, I will say C with C isomorphic to Z. It's more precise. So this is C in A and C in B. Okay. So such that, what? Such that, for instance, no conjugate of C in A intersects C. So this group with this strength condition is acting on the Bass Serre tree. Which correspond to the tree of spaces, which is a universal cover of this construction. And what's happening? Well, if you have a vertex fixed by A, then an edge fixed by C. If you have a neighboring edge, it's fixed by a conjugate of C, by an element of A. So it has trivial intersection. So no element fixes both edges. If you continue here, you have the group B, and you have here the group C conjugated by B. I did no assumption there, so maybe there is an element in the intersection of both, fixing both edges. But here again, I have some conjugate of A, and I know that around conjugates of A, nobody fixes two consecutive edges. So the worst that can happen is that I have an element fixing those two edges, which on the picture corresponds to here, continuing this cylinder by an element of B, and going there. That the unfolding of these two orange edges is this blue cylinder and this blue cylinder. Okay. So nobody fixes more than two edges, and we call that acylindrical. So maybe we understand now why acylindrical, because when I try to embed a cylinder in this construction, I'm stuck after two steps. I cannot continue. If I were able to continue and say, okay, this cylinder, oh, look, it goes in this strange space, comes back, and goes in this strange space, comes back, and so on, it would give me an element fixing a long segment in the tree, contradicting acylindricity. Cylinders contradict acylindricity, so terminology is more or less okay. More examples with no proofs. Well, relatively hyperbolic groups. Acting on their well, hyperbolic fine graphs. I should put plural here. So, why so? I said no proof. Okay. So, there are several things to check. So, here is a hyperbolic fine graph. And here are two points very far away and a geodesic between those two points. I have to check that. Elements that move them, both of them, of a small amount, they are finitely many. Unfortunately, there are infinitely many elements that move x by a small amount because of the non-local finiteness. But if I make an infinite list, at some point I find myself looking at an element which the path from X, so I have to draw a larger picture here. The path from X to G of X has to go through an infinite valence vertex and make a large angle. Now the same G applied to Y, it has to go to the same infinite valence vertex and make a similarly large angle. So it's not going to be close to Y, it's going to be that far to Y. So this way, which is arguably very sketchy, one can show that only finitely many elements move at bounded distance to points sufficiently far away.
What was the argument that has to go through the same vertex?
Oh, that's the same element. The same element consists of, as a word, it contains a large subword in the parabolic group. So, let me try to explain that differently. Yes, this element, apply it as an isometry to this segment. So now it starts here, and it is a segment which is isometric to this one. So if it has to go close to Y, I say that, okay. I say that it will have to go through this point. Assume it does not go through this point. Because of hypermolicity, it fellow travels. And when I moved like 500 delta, I'm okay to go there in short distance. And now I have a path from here to there, does not go through this vertex, so it bounds my angle. Okay, yep, I erased. But there are other examples which make the theory interesting, and I'd like to talk about one other example in particular, which will take me to the end of the lecture. It starts with a surface of genus larger than 2, and consider its mapping class group. Which is by definition the group of diffeomorphism of sigma G modulo isotopy, or modulo the connected component of the identity, or preserving orientation, I suppose. So this group is a very interesting group. So for instance, Dan Nielsen theorem tells you it is isomorphic to the outer automorphism group of sigma of G, of pi 1 of sigma of G. I did not put any base point because outer automorphism group is already quotiented by so what is it? It's the automorphism group quotiented by the inner automorphism group. Sorry. And the inner automorphism group is just conjugations by elements of pi 1 of sigma g. So it's moving the base point. So there are many ways to consider the group to be very interesting. That's one among many. After all, in the linear case, we are interested in GLNZ, which is the automorphism group of Z to the N. And here, we have an automorphism group of a hyperbolic lattice instead of an Euclidean lattice. So, I forgot to check what time was the beginning and end of this.
Good question. I think 10:30, right? Yeah.
I started at 10:30?
Kind of.
Okay.
The usual 10:30,
right? But what hyperbolic space can there be here for the mapping class group to act on? Let me define it. It will be the curve complex of sigma g, so the curve graph of sigma g is the graph whose vertices are homotopy classes of a simple closed curve. And edges are C1, C2, whenever we can realize the two curves of C1 and C2 as disjoint. To disjoint curves. So it's not particularly easy to see what it looks like. Let's say this will be C1. This will be C2. Maybe C3. And we have another color yet. C4. So I have no homotop curves in here. So I have, in this picture, the first four points on the graph, the curve graph. Oh, I lost my colors. So, I'm missing green. And what kind of edges do I have? I have an edge between C1 and C2. C1 and C4, so an edge blue-green and blue-orange. Should draw the edges in white. I have, what do I have? An edge between C4 and C3. So orange, purple. And that's it. It's not very. Yeah, okay. So, yeah. I cannot have an edge between C1 and C3 because I cannot homotop them to be disjoint. Oh, yeah, I should have maybe drawn this one, C5. C5 is disjoint from everyone except the green. So, good. Oh, no, and the purple. Oh, what did I do? What did I do? Come on, what did I do? No, no, it's fine.
It is
destroyed. Yeah. It is correct?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. So there are several facts about this curve graph. First, it is infinite and connected. And of infinite diameter. Well, it's not easy to see So for instance, that it has infinite diameter, but it's still true. But even more hard to see, so it goes without saying that I will not give much proofs now. So the theorem that interests me is about its geometry. And the theorem of Mazur and Minsky is that the curve graph is Gromboff hyperbolic. And there is an. Okay. What is easier to see is that the mapping class group acts on the curve graph. And the action of mapping class group sigma g on it is acylindrical. Yes?
Sorry, I didn't get it. The curve graph of what is infinite?
Oh, yes. Sigma g. For g larger than 2. Oh, you're asking? Yeah, everything is for sigma g for g larger than 2.
Okay, I didn't get it because you just drew the curve graph before.
It's not a full curve graph. It's just a few curves in the curve graph.
Oh, okay, yeah, okay.
Many other vertices. So, for instance, you can take the green curve and perform a dent twist over C5. So, a dent twist means that. Can I turn it into yellow? Yeah. Instead of crossing the white curve like that, I choose to just do some spiraling before. And similarly on the way back. Okay, I cannot draw it correctly. This is another simple closed curve. So the dent twist is a diffeomorphism of the surface. The identity on both side of a small cylinder centered at the curve, and which makes a progressive rotation along the cylinder. So, yeah. What did I do? Sorry. Yeah, so this gives, so the acylindricity of the action of the mapping class group on the curve complex is due to Bodich. And the hyperbolicity, so Bodich also gives a proof of hyperbolicity, but there are many proofs of hyperbolicity. The first one goes back to Mazur and Minsky. And there are very short proofs. I mean, a lot of people have worked on that. So. Yeah, so what to do with maybe I need a word to say that this is a larger class than relative hyperbolic groups. So observation, maybe. So those mapping class groups are not relative hyperbolic. Well, except relative to themselves. So non-trivially. There is an old theorem, I suppose Liquorish, that says that they are generated by den twists. Along some system of curves. But you see what's going on. So a den twist, again, what is a den twist? So you have somewhere a curve in your surface. You cut the surface left and right. Or maybe there is only one component in the complement, but never mind. You define the diffeomorphism to be the identity on away from the cylinder. And so here, you have a cylinder. So S1 times 0, 1. So you define it to be the identity on S1 times 0. You have no choice. It has to be identity on the left. The rotation of angle 2 pi t at s1t, and the rotation of angle 2 pi at s1 times 1, which is also the identity. So it turns this arc into this one. That's a den twist. Okay, but now, then twist on disjoint curve commute. Because because they have disjoint support. So every time I have two disjoint curves, I have a copy of Z square going into my mapping class group. If the mapping class group was relatively hyperbolic, this copy of Z square would have to be in the parabolic group. But now you see that when I change one curve, I get another Z square that share one factor with this Z square. So it has also, it must also be parabolic. And since it shares an infinite group with a previous parabolic group, it has to be in the same. So changing curves one at a time shows that the mapping class group is contained in one single parabolic. So this proves this observation that mapping class groups are not relatively hyperbolic. So it makes an interesting example of a cylindrical action which does not fall into the relative hyperbolicity phenomenon. So yeah.
This system of curves you talk about, is it finite?
Yeah, you can. Yes, it is finite. But for the argument, you don't even know, have to take that into account. Yes.
So why does all of the z squared have to be in the parabolic subgroup?
I'm sorry.
Why does the entirety of the z squared have to sit in the parabolic subgroup?
Oh, that's a general thing. So so it cannot be completely outside the parabolic for the same reason that z squared cannot embed in a hyperbolic group. If there was one element in a parabolic group, it would force everything to be there because it has a centralizer. So the centralizer will conjugate the parabolic group into some other group that intersect it infinitely on infinite subset. But it's not possible. Think about the horospheres, how they are well separated. The stabilizer of two disjoint horospheres have finite intersection. So this argument, again, of separation of the parabolic groups in relatively hyperbolic tells you that then the Z square must be completely in it. That's okay? Okay. Yeah, another comment on this example. In elements of the mapping class group, among the elements of the mapping class group, we have a classification which is due to Thurston that I will describe very briefly, not in the details. So if alpha is an element of the mapping class group of sigma g, there are three possibilities. Either alpha let me state it like there are two possibilities. Either some power preserves the curve simple closed curve, sorry. Or, so this contains, so for those who know the vocabulary, this contains well, finite order elements and reducible elements. Or you are pseudo-Anosov. Let me state it like that. So alpha is pseudo-Anosov. And maybe I take that as a definition. It is a loxodromic isometry on the complex of curves. On the graph of curves. So this statement tells us that so we have this mysterious graph, which is nonetheless hyperbolic and with an acylindrical action, and we know, we can pretend that we know loxodromic elements in this action. So loxodromic elements are those elements that preserve two points at infinity, preserve the collection of geodesics between these two points at infinity, and acts like a translation on these geodesics.
What is the infinity boundary? Because we know we are not hyperbolic.
On the curve complex, on the graph of curves, on the curve graph, I should be a little more systematic in my notations. The curve graph, on the curve graph. The curve graph is hyperbolic. Sorry. On the curve graph. So the curve graph is a good hyperbolic space. And it does not correspond to any space associated to a relatively hyperbolic structure. It comes from something weaker. And it's a hyperbolic space with an acylindrical action. And the question is, can we say something about the group then, thanks to this structure of acting acylindrically on a hyperbolic space? And the answer is well, yes. Maybe another observation from hyperbolicity. From acylindricity. I'm losing my words. Cylindricity. Well, I will explain what is going on. So if you take alpha, a pseudo-Anosov element in the mapping class group, and so it's loxodromic in the curve graph. So as I said, it preserves, in an ideal world, we would say it preserves an axis, preserves a B-infinite geodesic and translate on it. Well, unfortunately, it's not true. It preserves a finite set of B-infinite geodesics. And we'll spare you details. So let me just hide that under the word quasi. L, like line, be a quasi-axis for alpha. So it means that here I have my space, the curve graph, and here, well, maybe it's not just B-infinite geodesic, maybe it's more fuzzy, but think of it as a B-infinite geodesic, a line which is preserved by alpha and translated along it by alpha. And let a conjugate of alpha And assume that it's a genuine conjugate. You're not conjugating by some power of alpha. I mean, something that commutes here. Such that, how do I say that? Phi does not fix. Such that phi of L is different from L. So you have this line L, and we have another line phi of L. And I am worried about something that worried me before for relative hyperbolicity. I'm worried about how two things, how two convex subsets preserved by my favorite subgroup of the moment can be parallel. So you remember as it was a poison in relative hyperbolicity, and we build in the definition that parabolic groups stabilize convex sets that are not parallel for a long time, that quickly diverge from each other. So what happens here? I have my favorite alpha preserving a convex set and my favorite my conjugate beta preserving another convex set. Can they be parallel for a long time? Well, Asilendri tells us that no. Then alpha, well, the if I take the neighborhood of alpha of like 10 delta, and I intersect it with the neighborhood of, it's not L, of L with 10 delta, with neighborhood of phi L with 10 delta, well, this is uniformly bounded. This is, yeah. Now let me sketch this on the picture.
Question. When you say uniformly bounded, do you mean no matter which L we choose?
No matter which phi, which phi. So let me sketch that for you. If it was not, there would be a very long case here. So what to do? Then I can take a point here and make alpha. Oh, this is very long, like I can do alpha to the 1,000,000 and still be in the subsegment. I take alpha to the power k0, k. Then I'm doing beta to the power, L. Then I'm doing alpha inverse to the power k. And then beta inverse. Since everything lies in the parallelisms of the two axes, I'm going back to almost the same point. So this commutator quasi-fixes something here. And the same happens everywhere in the superposition of the axis, as long as I don't fall in the divergence. So it will do the same here again. So the same commutator, alpha k beta l, quasi-fixes. Sorry. If not, so if there is a long subsegment, alpha k beta l quasi-fixes two points far away in this intersection. But this cannot be the trivial element. It has to be new elements every day. Because if it was trivial, then some power of alpha commutes with some power of beta, meaning that their axes are the same. And I assume that they will not be the same. So quasi-fixing two points far away in this intersection is exactly the condition in the asymmetricity So it contradicts asymmetricity.
How do we have to think about the boundary point of the curve, graph?
Yeah, projective. Yeah, there's a theorem of Grossman that identifies the boundary in terms of projective measured lamination. So what's the exact statement? I just cannot say the exact statement now on the top of my head, but yeah.
Would it be possible to do that with the Teichmüller space and some of this, for example, the pseudonosov element, and they act more or less like a logarithmic element on the Teichmüller space?
Yeah, okay. Well, I guess it's possible to interpret a part of all this story in Teichmüller space. Teichmüller space has no is not naturally hyperbolic for any of the usual metric we like. But there are contraction properties, and the contraction properties are reminiscent to hyperbolicity. And actually, that's part of the reason why we can see curve complex is indeed hyperbolic. So what to say? I guess you could interpret part of this story in it, but without the you cannot use hyperbolicity for truth. So it's like walking on one leg.
It's not as cylindrically hyperbolic.
Oh, it's not hyperbolic. Teichmüller space is not hyperbolic.
No, but relative or asymptotically hyperbolic. Like a weaker version.
Well, you do have a map from Teichmüller space to the curve complex. So you could say, through this map, the electrification of this map gets again the hyperbolicity properties of a curve complex, but that's hiding it. Okay. Let me finish with an application. So we do have this control on the intersection of convex sets, and so applications. And that's a result I obtained with Girardel and Ossin. I will not detail them. I just say what they're like. There is an analog of the Denfeling theorem for quotienting out pseudo-Anosov elements. So let me state very vaguely a Denfeling theorem for some subgroups of mapping class group. Well, that's not a statement, is it? So let me give you a statement. Actually, we can find a free subgroup of the mapping class group on which we can perform the Denfeling theorem. And as an application, mapping class groups are SQ universal. Meaning that any countable, finitely generated, or countable, it's group is a subgroup of a quotient of its SQ means sub-quotient universal. So every countable group is a subgroup of a certain quotient of the mapping class group. So it's done by then filling a free subgroup generated by pseudo-Anosov's. I would like to finish with other examples. Well, actually, I don't know where. Well, maybe I stop here. Thank you.